Listening Library presents Lucky for Good, the final story in Lucky's Hardpan Trilogy by Susan Patron. Read for you by Cassandra Campbell. Encore pour René de mon cœur. Chapter 1. Enemies. The enemies invaded the trailers. Many crept in alone, others arrived in organized platoons. They concealed themselves and built secret tiny nests and lairs. Some of them bit, stung, and pinched. Others clogged, soiled, smudged, and polluted. Lucky's mom, Brigitte, faced these foes like a general in World War III. She mopped, swept, vacuumed, scoured, scrubbed, washed, polished, and sterilized. She was okay with the work. It was just part of living in the little desert town of Hardpan, population 43, which Brigitte had adopted as her home when she adopted Lucky as her daughter. Lucky herself had a live-and-let-live attitude toward Brigitte's enemies, those mice, ants, flying ants, tarantula hawk wasps, scorpions, beetles, crickets, spiders, flies, and moths, plus sand, dust, dirt, grit, and dog hair. The creatures were all just doing their jobs, trying to eat and not get eaten, make a home, have children, live their urgent tiny lives. Lucky tried to help Brigitte see things from their point of view, but it was no use. Brigitte did not care one bit about the point of view of a bug. So, Lucky was pretty conscientious about keeping the screen door closed and not tracking in dirt. She wiped down the tables on weekends, when Brigitte's Hardpan Cafe was open for lunch, and she bussed and washed dirty dishes. But the problem with bugs is that they don't care if a certain area belongs to you, like a shelf in your bedroom or a corner under the sink. All they know is it seems like a good place to settle down. So Lucky had to be vigilant and keep up her guard, hunting and capturing the larger insects and releasing them outside. She did her best, but sometimes all that cleaning and enemy fighting wore Lucky out. It made her wish she were back at her old job at the Found Object Wind Chime Museum and Visitor Center, which she'd given up because of having too much else to do. For that job, she just kept the patio clean and raked. She didn't have to worry about dust or insects. And then a certain realization bonked Lucky over the head. Nothing stays clean. Sooner or later, the thing will have to be cleaned again. The floor, the stove, tables, pots, forks, napkins, feet, paws. The never-endingness of cleaning made a quick little what-if thought spring into her mind. The what-if was like an online pop-up, which you're forced to look at even if you don't want to. It wasn't a wish that she hoped would come true, but still, there it was, blinking at her from the corner of the screen in her mind. It was this. What if, for some reason, Brigitte's Hardpan Cafe just, poof, disappeared? Well, life would be way different. There would be so much less work. Brigitte could get a regular job, and they would have weekends just for themselves to do fun things instead of working. But then Lucky reminded herself of the good parts. Like that Brigitte wasn't homesick for France, because here in California, she had a strict boss, but it was herself. And every day when Lucky got back from school, she was greeted twice. First with a dog kiss from HMS Beagle, who was waiting at the bus drop-off, and then with a hug and a mom kiss from Brigitte. Plus, Lucky was proud that Brigitte's cooking was famous for miles around, and all on their own, they were making the cafe a success. Tourists who found them told their friends, and local people from Sierra City and other towns started coming every single weekend. It was a kind of miracle. And Brigitte said it could never have happened without Lucky. So Lucky felt ashamed about what-ifing the cafe's disappearance even for a second. She put on her yellow rubber gloves and got to work. But then a new enemy appeared and started a different kind of battle. Chapter 2. A Clipboard. At first, Lucky thought it was just another hungry person. The man who pulled up in a truck with Inyo County Health Department, State of California, stenciled on its door. Early customer, Lucky joked. It being Friday afternoon and the cafe not open until tomorrow noon. She watched from inside the kitchen trailer as the man stood by his truck, looking at the tables and at the A-frame sign, Brigitte's Hardpan Cafe, open for lunch, déjeuner, Saturday, Sunday, and holidays. Non, said Brigitte, also peering out the high window. This man has a clipboard, and that is never good. Bending down to use the toaster as a mirror, Brigitte applied lipstick and checked her hair before stepping into the open doorway.
Afternoon, ma'am,
the man said, reaching down, flat-fingered, to let HMS Beagle scent his hand. He eyed Brigitte from under the bill of his cap, looking suddenly less official and more like a big, clumsy, friendly bear. But not sure as to the correct etiquette and wanting to make a good impression, Lucky, unnoticed, smiled to herself. Brigitte often made that impression on people, even in her thrift store hospital scrubs, her hair in a hasty ponytail. They wanted her to like them. The man held his clipboard partially behind his leg, like when Lucky's friend Miles tried to hide a stolen cookie. Brigitte smiled brilliantly at him and then looked apologetic. We are not open today, she said, glancing meaningfully at the sign. But maybe you return tomorrow for lunch? The man removed his cap, then didn't seem to know what to do with it. He put it back on his head, the bill a little lower, as if to look more serious. When he raised the clipboard, Lucky knew he was only pretending to read it. She crossed her arms and brought one bare foot up to rest on the opposite calf of her jeans. She wanted to show the man that he couldn't just drive up any time of the day or night and expect the cafe to be open. And he couldn't come around and try to scare them by acting so official. Maybe Brigitte was afraid of burrows and snakes, but she was totally fearless about people. This made Lucky herself feel brave. She frowned at Mr. Inyo County Health Department mightily. He cleared his throat.
Brigitte Trimble?
He asked, his voice deep. He planted his feet apart like a cop about to make an arrest, the clipboard now in both hands like a shield.
Lucky, please look in the drawer to the left of the stove and bring to me the red folder,
Brigitte said, not taking her clear, defiant gaze off the man.
I show you my business and fictitious name permit, she said to him, if that is what you have come to check.
Well, okay,
he agreed, as Lucky darted up the steps to the kitchen trailer.
But this is about regulation number 1849. I'm Stu Burping from County Health. Mind if I have a look at the kitchen?
Brigitte did not react. But as Lucky dashed back out with the folder, she thought, Stu Burping, who works for the County Health Department? Stu Burping? She imagined telling this tidbit of information to her best friend, Paloma, and the two of them actually dying from laughter overdose.
The clerk in Independence has assured me that my papers are in order, Brigitte said, lifting her chin. But of course you may see the kitchen. We have no vermin or bug, if that is what you wonder.
Lucky hoped strongly that this man hadn't found out about the time she'd accidentally left a jar of tomato worms under a cafe table. Brigitte went on.
The freezer and fridge are kept always at the correct temperature.
Lucky glared at the man. He would never find a cleaner kitchen, that's for sure. And Brigitte was extremely strict about following the guidelines of the online, certified course in restaurant management and administration with diploma from the Culinary Institute of France in Paris. Stu Burping was a little hunched, Lucky noticed, and she realized he was older than she first thought. Maybe as old as 55 or 65. Anyway, in that extreme age zone where the backs of their hands and their necks are wrinkled and they get ear hair. Grandfather age.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.